Inside New Orleans Sports with Eric Asher is the first place award winner of the 2015 New Orleans Press Club's Excellence in Journalism Award for the category of Best TV Sports Show.
Good evening, New Orleans, and welcome to Inside New Orleans Sports. I'm your host, Eric Asher. Over the next hour, we're going to cover all the sports. That's right, we're going to cover the New Orleans Saints, New Orleans Pelicans, the LSU Tigers, and the Tulane Green Wave, and I promise you that. And we got a great panel to do it tonight. Gus Kattengill of ESPN 100.3, the Sports Hangover, and Scott Kuster of the New Orleans Advocate. And gentlemen, welcome to the show. Thanks so much for being with us. And Gus, congratulations on your new gig.
Yeah.
I don't like the new time slot because I can't listen anymore.
Wonder else who's on
you
that
get
time.
The middle.
Exactly.
You want to get in the middle?
Yeah, exactly. You know, but other than the other time slot, I'm just so happy for you. Right. Tell the folks about the new gig, station, everything that's going on with the original Sports Hangover.
I do miss that too because you do tell it like it is, and believe me, in this city, we definitely need you.
Thank you. And the same for you. Yeah, I really enjoy listening to you in the afternoon.
I will say this though, my wife loves the fact that I am on now 11 to 1. Mm-hmm. I don't mind getting off at 1 o'clock in the afternoon. The only problem is I thought it would be a little more time freeing. I'm basically Gussarella. You know, it's chores, it's laundry. Yeah. Hey, might as well have dinner ready. But yeah, ESPN New Orleans, the new home, it's fantastic. At 11 to 1, and more than anything else, it's cool that like a day like today, there's live baseball that's mm-hmm. on. You know, we have Major League Baseball, the NBA playoffs, all that stuff, college football, all the home there.
Great. Now, same type of show, Gus, that you've always done?
Absolutely, same type.
Beautiful,
same
beautiful. Type. That's great. Well, I'll have to catch you on the podcast. Scott, welcome back to the show. Always good to have you. Tell us a little bit about what's happening at the New Orleans Advocate.
Still doing a whole lot of everything still. I'm currently covering somewhere, dipping my toe in Tulane there, you know, writing one or two stories a week. And at the same time, now pretty much full-blown Pelicans at this point. Since we're in October into training camp, I was over there today, and I'll be over there, you know, Saturday when they get back. So it's been a lot of Pelicans coverage.
Well, I'll tell you, we're going to get into Pelicans and Tulane today. Mm-hmm. I promise. Saints, well, a much needed win, guys, huh? I mean, we talked about it last week. I've talked about it on the radio show. I'm sure you guys have talked about it as well. This team had won a game. Mm-hmm. I mean, this group had not tasted victory preseason or regular season. 26-20 overtime win over the Dallas Cowboys. They're now 1-3. And what a panacea for the city and for the team, and a much needed win.
Absolutely. And I think the thing that's interesting, too, is perspective, right? We had a caller that we played on our show back on Monday, Shirley from Philly. And it was one of the sports talk radio stations there. They want Chip Kelly's head on a platter. Not even silver is just the quickest way they can get the head off the body. They're not happy with the offense. They're not happy. Mind you, 2-10-6 seasons, right? Mm-hmm. And they're not happy. So it is interesting when you look at perspective because you're right. Saints win on Monday and everyone's there's hope.
Yes.
Look, we feel good right? about ourselves. So it's the hardest thing when the most interesting. And I'm sure, Scott, you're doing the same thing when you talk to people on Twitter, is trying to get the perspective of the Saints fans to understand one very important thing. This isn't the 09, the 2011 New Orleans Saints when they won 9 in a row, when they won the Super Bowl. You had a much more veteran and more athletic and better receiving core. Yes. You don't have Devery Henderson and a young Marcus Colston and Robert Meacham and players of that nature. You don't have an offensive line that after the Saints won the Super Bowl and made those runs, yeah, you left tackle, the guard and Carl Nix, the center. Mm-hmm. You had to keep replacing parts because they were going to get bigger deals on other teams. Teron Armstead might be the only one that other team may want. Max Unger, I get it, but Teron Armstead is it, right?
Right.
Defensively, you're looking at, 6 of the top 8 tacklers from Sunday's game? Rookies. Mm-hmm. It's a different team. It's a rebuilding team. And, you know, you call it retooling, spring cleaning if you want, but that's how I've been trying to presented to fans is just understand who they are. This isn't a team that can overcome turnovers and penalties as easily before. It's going to be tight games. It's going to be ugly games, and they're going to have to play almost flag-free.
Yeah. Scott, what can you add?
I just really think this team is devoid of talent in a lot of different areas. And you mentioned it a little bit. I mean, you look at that. You look at any team in the NFL starting that many rookies on defense, and you go, that's a bad team. Right. For some reason, people look at that team and say, well, this is a team that can still compete for the playoffs because they have Drew Brees. Quarterback is far and away the most important position in the NFL. But when you are having to play the guys that this team is having to play, I mean, Damian Swan is like a huge contributor to this defense. It's bizarre. Aloy Kikaha is playing well, and everyone's like, well, he's like the second best player on the defense.
Exactly, right.
That guy couldn't play at all in 2010 or 2009 if he was on this team. Right. And those weren't great defenses. Those are great offenses.
That's a great point.
Offense has completely shut down in a lot of ways. I mean, there is no passing over the top. There is very little room in the running game for the most part. All the things that this team did well, what all the fans are kind of expecting to see, is gone.
Yes.
And so even when you kind of look around and say, oh, you know, they've got some hope now this week, I just don't see how this team can win nine games. I have a very difficult time.
Well, guys, I've said and I've cautioned the fans all season long, you got to take this by the quarters. You know, you're 1-3 in the first quarter. You got to look at the second quarter. And all you can hope at this point, because of the turnover in the roster, is that these guys are going to get better by the third and fourth quarters of the season. If you're thinking that all of a sudden that just because they've won one game that they've turned the season around, they're going to go on this run like we've seen in with past Saints teams, you're fooling yourself at this point. Honestly, take it one game at a time and hope for some improvement with the young players, because that's what they're hanging their hat on right now. I mean, and you made a great point, Scott. A lot of these guys, you know, they were in college last year. They won practice squads. They were in the CFL. A lot of these guys haven't even been in an NFL weight room for a year. I mean, sometimes you look at them going against other teams, and you're looking at going, well, wait a minute, just look at the size of difference in the team. So this is a work in progress, and I think that, again, the fan base has to be patient. Maybe the team didn't want to say rebuilding, but I think it's pretty obvious to everyone right now this is a rebuilding team.
It's no question, and I think the Akeem Hicks move, absolutely, if you don't think it's happening, it is. So. You know, you talk about now trusting Tyler Davidson. You're talking about Bobby Richardson. So we're talking about a late draft pick and also an undrafted rookie pick for you to be able to do that.
Guys that wouldn't have played in a lot of good teams.
Totally agree.
And not that they're not filling a role and playing well, but they are not playing if they play for a playoff team for the most part.
True.
Those guys are in the depth.
That's the key, what he just said there, too, playoff team. Because we've been under not the impression or guys, because that's what we've been talking about, which is nuts when you think a year ago everyone was writing. We were all drunk, apparently. It was a Super Bowl team.
Why wouldn't you?
Right?
The year
everyone,
before. Come
right?
on.
It's crazy when you think a year ago we were going Super Bowl contenders, because we thought, hey, here's the championship window. Now, look, we can do a whole hour on the effects 2012 had in the bounty thing. It did. It absolutely
did.
So you look at it, though, and him being away for a year and Sean Payton and just seeing where this team was. But we talked about it before we went on the air today, guys. You cannot have no members from the 2012 draft. You cannot have one player from the 2014 draft and Brandon Cooks, who we're waiting to see the potential in. You cannot keep striking out on free agents with the small amount of money that you can spend because of the Drew Brees deal, the Jimmy Graham deal, the Gallette deal, which at the time you had to budget because you gave them that deal. They're no longer here, you know, other than Brees. And those are failures. Jairus Byrd, it's nothing personal. That move is a failure right now, you know? And so if you're looking at all that, Champ Bailey, so it's a blueprint on how to go from being successful to not.
Well, it's self-inflicted wounds, isn't it, Scott? I mean, you look at, as I've mentioned, again, one player per draft since 2007 making an impact. As Gus just said, just the snapshot of the last few drafts, not being able to have contributors. Then you're looking at 20% of your roster is again, dead money. You got $31 million out there. As I've mentioned on both my shows, the old Tom Benson, heads would have been rolling for again, $31 million not on the team. So, again, they really have squandered the riches that they had, and now they're trying to get it back maybe in one shot, a nice 15 draft, and hope they can augment that with some guys that are coming back from injury. It's going to be a process here, because you don't know what you're going to get from one week to the next with these rookies.
And not to pile on negative, because I think what you can see here is that Mickey Loomis has addressed a lot of the issues.
Right.
Mickey Loomis was not afraid to say, look, you got to go, Rick Reipersch. You got to, I mean, some of these, the scouting department, he said he pushed people out of the door. And I think there are definitely GMs in this league who've had success, who've won Super Bowls, who would not be pushing people who helped them get there out of the door. And Mickey Loomis, I think, sat back, addressed it, and addresses the fact that they had failures. And when you saw this draft class, it looks totally different than the last few. There were not nearly as many reaches, maybe the exception of Andres Pete, but you had a lot of guys who could step in, play immediately, and hopefully build with the team. And guys who are playing right now, and you're gonna see where those guys kind of contribute going forward. But I do respect that fact. Everything that you said, though, of his failures is very obvious and very true.
Well, and I'm not going to lay it all on Mickey Loomis, because I'm going to lay it where it belongs, which is Sean Payton. He makes the call on the football side when it comes to personnel. Now, whether, again, this was a situation where the brain trust of the Saints got together and said, man, we are just missing horribly on these draft choices, because at the end of the day, there's no way Sean Payton, our defensive coordinator, or anyone else that's on the coaching staff can tell you what a college player has done.
Right.
You're relying on the scouts to give you a thumbnail sketch on what this guy's about, and then you try to figure out if they're going to fit in your system with your team. So a lot of what you're taking is from what the scouts are doing, and obviously pro personnel, and of course at this point there needed to be a house cleaning, and you know, we'll see what happens going forward, but there is some encouragement by what you saw against Dallas on Monday night.
There is, and I think one of the things that Scott touched on earlier in the show, he used the T word, talent. There's no doubt about it. I mean, you need talent. You need speed to get open, right? You need blockers in order to block for Drew Brees. But it's also a character issue, too. You saw the emphasis, and you mentioned the draft, 6 out of 9 on defense, but they all have a common theme to them all. Either they overcome injury or they have adversity. They all have chips on their shoulders. They're good character
like
guys.
Like 06.
Exactly. So it's I go with exactly what Scott's saying. They, at the very least, and it's the hardest thing to do. We all try to do it every now and then, whether it's our writing, our shows, TV, radio, just our personal lives, to be able to look into a mirror and self-critique. That's the hardest thing to do. So, to your point, there are some positives. We did see it. He brought up Damian Swan. You know, you are seeing Kekaha make an impact. 3 straight games with a sack. Hey, does he look the part? Is he fast? It's a sack.
Tyler Davidson looked a heck of a lot better than Akeem Hicks.
Oh, yeah,
didn't
for
he?
Sure.
You know,
right.
It's like that defensive line actually had life for the first time.
Yeah.
So, like you're saying, that they finally started to build it a little bit. And I think you saw the interior line finally come on
as well. Look at Willie Snead. He's like 3rd on the team in receptions. Look, is he going to be a guy that sells jerseys? I don't know. I mean, the city fell in love and found the spot for Lance Moore, but that's the kind of guy he is. At the very least, and it goes back to how he started this, it's the offensive, the receivers. You got to find the talent there. Somebody's got to get open.
Well, that's also a problem with, again, what happened to this team in the offseason. You know, you got to be smart and calculated enough to know that if you're going to get rid of Kenny Stills and Jimmy Graham, you got to bring someone in.
Yeah.
They really didn't do it. I mean, they didn't go out and find another player. They didn't draft another receiver. You know, they're counting on 2 guys coming off a practice squad.
Right.
Okay, one of the guys made it off the practice squad in Brandon Coleman, and they didn't even know they had Snead. They didn't know what they had in Snead.
No, you're
and Snead's
absolutely
probably
right.
The most, again, he's the most reliable receiver they have on this team right now.
Yeah, he's more so than Colson.
Absolutely.
He has more yards than Brandon Cooks. There's no way any of us would have sat here months ago and said, through the first quarter of the season, Willie Snead would have more yards receiving than Brandon Cooks.
How much that has to do with Drew Brees not being able to get the ball over the top, though. I think that's we talk about the receivers. When you can't get the ball over the top, you really make it difficult on those deep threats to get anything
But
going.
Who is a deep threat, honestly?
Cooks.
I mean, again, at this point, Joe Morgan was here, he's gone.
Right. Yeah.
You know, they don't even want to play Cooks on the outside and be able to allow him to be the deep threat. They want to use him, obviously, in the short bubble screens, etc. They really lack that deep threat right now. And look, I know you can't cover everything that you've lost in one offseason, but you should have realized going into this thing that, you know what, Brees needs some weapons. Now they've kind of changed the offense. The guy that maybe could make the difference, the guy that came back this week, is C.J. Spiller.
Mm-hmm.
They've got to get a way to get him on the field and start to utilize him. You know, they've done it with Sproles, they've done it with Bush, and they had better surrounding cast. Now he's kind of the go-to guy right now going forward.
I thought last year, Scott and Eric, Brandon Cooks was the guy that I thought the offense was going to move towards. And obviously with Graham, it kind of helps in doing those things. And I just threw it out there. I said 10 targets a game. I don't care if it's a handoff, a short pass, a dump pass, a shot, doesn't matter. I think C.J. Spiller is that this year. You got to get him 5 to 10 targets a game, whether it's a toss, a screen, the wheel route, which he does well. But you got to get C.J. Spiller some touches.
What's your thoughts, Scott?
He absolutely is the one guy on this roster that can make a 70-yard touchdown, mm-hmm. which we saw.
Yeah.
He's the only guy on that field, but maybe the exception of Brandon Cooks, who when he gets the ball in the open field like that is going to score. And with this team's red zone troubles and those kind of issues, those 40, 50-yard touchdowns become a very big deal. And they used to score those in bunches.
Yes.
Drew Brees used to throw over the top, and they would beat teams by getting a couple long touchdowns a game. Mm-hmm. You just simply haven't seen that for 2 years now. But this is really going to come down to Brees offensively. I think Max Unger was a terrific addition mm-hmm. in the middle. You just watch him play.
Oh, yeah.
He looks like he knows what he's doing. He's screaming at teammates. He is in Kelemente's face.
Yeah, I mean, you wonder how good he could be if he actually had two guards.
If he had Jari Evans and Carl Nix next to him.
Exactly.
That
was where Brees was best.
Absolutely.
When that interior line, it allows him to step up. And we saw it a couple times against Dallas.
The two-minute drill to end the game.
He can step up.
Yeah.
And he couldn't do that at all last year.
Right.
And he really couldn't do it much in the first couple weeks.
No, I would agree. And you know, Scott, I'll add this to it. First half against Dallas, deplorable. I mean, Brees running for his life.
Yeah.
They adjusted in the second half, and they were a much better offensive line. Now, you got to hope that the anchor of that line, Teron Armstead, doesn't have an injury that's going to linger the entire season. We just found out that Jari Evans has been scoped. Kelemente has not done a bad job,
yeah.
you know, but and I could even say right now, probably doing a better job than an aging Jari Evans at this point, but
right.
you've got to have Teron Armstead.
He is key. He is no doubt about it. And it was brutal to watch him just gut it out and tough it out. I think he showed a lot of character in there. And I think it also comes from Drew Brees, though, right? During the week, he didn't want to talk mm-hmm. about the shoulder. He kept saying everyone deals with things. And I think when you see your quarterback in there getting hit, saying, hey, we still have a shot to win the game. That two-minute drill, I talked to Drew about it on Wednesday and a lot of players in the locker room on Wednesday. Could it be a defining moment or a turning point on that offense? On that drive, no timeouts, just over a minute mm-hmm. left. It was like a surgeon, right? Going down the field.
It was Saints
Brandon
of old.
Brandon Coleman yeah. caught a pass. Willie Snead mm-hmm. caught a pass. The line gave him a tremendous pocket. There was no pressure. And you almost just wonder if something like that can just...
He didn't throw an interception.
Throw an interception.
Everyone's sitting there going,
but he wasn't
when's he
going to
throw an
yeah,
exactly. And that's the difference, yeah. is that he wasn't getting hit,
yeah.
and he wasn't trying to squeeze it into triple coverage
True.
With somebody in his face, you know, and trying to get it to Jimmy Graham's hand. It was a very different look
right.
from what we've seen the last 2 years in a two-minute situation.
Well, I'll say this, Scott. One good thing is Lewis comes back, Ellerby comes back, Bird comes back. Mm-hmm. That's going to help that defense.
That's the talent. That's the talent right. injection. I don't know if Keenan Lewis necessarily has at this point. I mean, he looked banged up.
He
didn't
did.
Look nearly – and even in the preseason, he didn't look very good. If you remember, DeAndre Hopkins kind of really
Ran
hurting
right
him
him
one-on-one.
Yeah.
Bro's the best cover corner they have,
mm-hmm.
and he's not perfect by
right.
any stretch. But Brandon Browner is truly cannot play man-to-man.
No way.
Coverage like that. He's good at the run protection,
mm-hmm.
but that was not a great pickup when you need him to play in that situation.
Well, and you can't play zone with Brandon Browner,
no.
okay? He needs, again, Bird over the top.
Yes.
Or you're going to put him on the inside and maybe let him match up against a tight end. Look, his leadership, his physicality, you need all of that. But you can't put him in a position where he can't be successful. And they were kind of pushed into that because they just didn't have the body.
Right.
So much so that I kind of mused, maybe it's time for Damian Swan to take that spot.
To move up.
Yeah, no doubt about it. And, you know, you brought it up, the point, which is kind of something you started the show out with as to where you want to see the Saints in the third and fourth quarter. I thought because of the schedule, because of the injuries coming out of training camp, 4-4, I wouldn't be upset. 5-3, I'm applauding the job mm-hmm. that the team has done because I think in the second 8 games, it can maybe make that run to 8-9 wins, and you don't know
right.
where the NFL's going to be there. But while we're on the topic of I want or you need or you want this, how about Kenny Vaccaro? Can we find where that guy 2
yeah.
years ago was?
Right.
Because he can be an impact player on defense. We saw that. I thought last year was a complete mistake
mm-hmm.
when Sean Payton said we're taking away the roving. He needs to rove.
Yes.
He needs to roam. He needs to I'm trying to think of the last time you saw him doing that. And I asked him going into that game last week on where are the blitzes. But you can't when you're using backups and you have the injuries.
Yep.
And I said, you know, on our show, I said, watch him be a blitzer again against Dallas. And sure enough, he was going
mm-hmm.
back in. But that's because you got Bird, you got Lewis, you got Swan playing well. So I do think you're going to see the defense be a little more aggressive because you have the veterans back.
866-3200 is the phone number. Let's head to the phone lines. Greg is in Houma. Greg, welcome to Inside New Orleans Sports. Hey, Greg.
Yeah, I got a statement and then another question. My statement is Dallas was supposed to have a very good offensive line, as advertised, but, I mean, I thought our defense put a little bit of pressure on them, and I want to know what you guys think about that. My second question is now that Morstead is hurt, what is Sean Payton's strategy for special teams, especially since our place kicker is kind of shaky? Mm-hmm. And I hang up and listen.
Thank you so much. They did a pretty good job, Scott, against the Dallas offensive line. I got to tell you, I mean, I was really impressed considering that's the best offensive line in football.
Yeah, after the game, I tweeted it because, there's a lot of snide remarks during the game. But that was a really impressive performance by that defensive front, especially with guys like Tyler Davidson and Bobby Richardson. I mean, Cam Jordan played fine, but you don't have any experience, Pro Bowl level, whatever, and you're going up against probably the best and an offensive line in the entire NFL. And they made Brandon Whedon work. And he didn't. The fear in that game was he was just going to stand back there, and I don't care how bad you are as a quarterback, if you just stand back there in the pocket and you have time to pick people apart, you will. And he wasn't allowed to do that. And credit Rob Ryan, credit that defensive line, though, for really coming to play on a night game in a game they desperately needed.
Yeah, and again, I think it goes back to just being able to get some bodies again. Mm-hmm. Like I said, it was nice to see in the first quarter. Not that I like to pat myself on the back, but I do. and there's Vaccaro lined up at the line, and his helmet is right into the quarterback. He's blitzing, and I'm like, all right, fine, here we are, finally. So you are seeing that, and I agree with the caller. It was a fantastic job, but at D-line, because he got pressure, and you're starting to get the sacks, and you're starting to get just some hurries. And on the special teams aspect of it, look, Thomas Morstead's a weapon. There's no doubt about it. And that's going to be a big-time thing. I know the guy they brought in Fields.
Brandon Fields.
Yeah, he's got some credentials.
He's going to be able to punt for a few weeks till he gets back.
Right.
Hocker's going to handle the kickoffs. Hocker's got to get it. This is kind of the last straw.
But he may be told he's just going to point.
If he misses another field goal, he's on the unemployment line.
He's going to go Pat Hayden style. They're going to meet him on the offensive
line. And then you've got a question again. Remember,
just as he comes off the field.
Guys, Dustin Hopkins, 6-for-6, game-winning field goal. Yeah. You almost got to say, man, you picked the wrong guy.
How about Kyra Santos making
from
seven field goals
exactly
for Kansas City?
And he's in your
backyard. And he played in your stadium. Yeah. And they still, and they've been looking for a kicker since 2010.
Yeah, yeah. They may have some New Orleans guys on the team, but they surely don't look toward LSU and Tulane. That's
10 kickers in the Sean Payton era if he gets rid of Zach Hocker. And on Sunday, I saw a tweet that Peter King put out there. 14 kickers in the NFL, guys, missed chip shot field goals or PATs.
Yeah.
So it's what the league wanted. It's what the, they kind of wanted to make it a little more difficult, the extra point. And there you go.
Wallace is in New Orleans. Wallace, welcome to Inside New Orleans Sports. Hey, Wallace.
How you doing?
What's happening?
Hey, my man. I just want to know, when the Saints go play Philadelphia, and bad as Philadelphia playing right now, do you think our Saints going to go up there and bow down and let Philadelphia get their old, beat us, everything just come good for them? And I'm going to sit back and listen to what you got
appreciate
to say.
It, Wells. Well, obviously, first of all, they got to protect Breeze. Mm-hmm. On the defensive side, they've got to be gap disciplined. And, again, this is a young defense. You get into that read option that they like to run up there. Again, Bradford has not done a great job with that. But to me, again, they're going to be – it's a fast-break offense. They're going to be on the field. Their tongue's going to be hanging out at some point. So we'll learn a lot about this defense this week. And also, again, how they've dealt with success as well.
Yeah, that was a question this week on how the team is going to deal with it. But I think one of the things you're going to see this week that you've got going for the Saints is maybe threefold, okay? A, they want Chip Kelly – head on a platter. I can't say that enough. So if the Saints can get off to a nice fast start, the booze will start cascading in Lincoln Financial.
Yes,
that's going to happen. They're terrible in the time of possession because of that offense you're talking about. Just like any offense, Sean Payton's offense, when defensive coordinators have time, have seasons, have game film after game film, now 3 years in, there's a reason Philadelphia's 1-3. There's a reason they've struggled offensively to score, right? The last first year, 2 years, they led the NFL in offense. They're not now. Defensive coordinators know how to stop it. Bradford struggled. Jason LaConfora from CBSSports.com Monday column. Time to bench Bradford. It's time for Mark Sanchez. That's what the Saints are going into on Sunday. It's a team that I think is holding on to the brink. There's unhappiness there. Mm-hmm. DeMarco Murray, guys, is averaging 15 yards a game, they paid him $40 million. Yeah. So do they kind of go out of sorts, and is this the week they force feed him 25, 30 carries? And then that plays into the Saints' game plan where you're not worried about that fast break. I think this is an interesting game because Philly, I think they can be had just because they're holding on a tether, I think, sometimes right now.
Scott, what can you add?
I'm going to have a very odd point, which is I think we talked about how many rookies that they're playing. All those guys saw spread offenses.
Great point.
For the last 4 years.
That's a great point.
Right. Those guys have all looked at spread
offenses.
Right.
All that,
and
right?
If they're starting four or five rookies out there who are very used to this, you're not playing nine-year NFL veterans who are not conditioned to play in this guy. Yeah. Politi Kaha is the perfect fit to play against this kind of offense.
Yep.
I don't know if it's going to make a lick of difference by the time they actually get on the field. But I think it's a little bit of an advantage, at least for the Saints. But the New Orleans, they're going to have to score.
Right. Yeah.
More than anything, this offense has to get going. This team is not going to win games 13-10 and 17-10, whatever. Right. They have to be able to put up high 20s, 30 points.
Excellent point, Scott. Excellent. I thought about that all week long. That's an excellent point. That really is. Julie is in Metairie. Julie, welcome to Inside New Orleans Sports.
Yes, dear.
Hey, Julie.
I have two or three questions I need to ask you if you have time.
Surely.
Okay. The problem with Morstead now is that we don't have a kicker. Mm-hmm. And I thought I remembered prior to the beginning of the season when we were trying two kickers out. I remember Morstead saying how happy he was that these kickers could kick it out of the end zone or to the back of the end zone. As soon as the season started, Morstead is kicking off. Mm-hmm. Now, this doesn't make sense to me. Why would you use this man who's told you he uses different muscles to kick off than he does to punt, and then you get him injured? You have the kicker we have to kick it out of the end zone.
Right.
Something is not right in the management here.
Mm-hmm.
We talked about Brandon Cooks. Mm. He cost us two draft picks.
Yes.
And we let Darren Sproles go.
Yes.
Last year, Darren Sproles was all pro. You begin to look at the Saints and you say to yourself, what's going on here? Because they'll tell you, 2 years ago we had the great defense, and the coach said, I can take Michael Jenkins and put him anywhere. I thought we had drafted him as a quarterback.
Mm-hmm.
But they used him as a safety.
Yes.
You remember 3 or 4 years ago, we had an interception at the goal line, and he ended up coming across field and hitting the guy before he could score?
Mm-hmm.
I mean, why do you let men like this go? Because he's playing for someone else.
Oh, yes, and he's doing well. He's doing well. Thank you for the phone call, Julie. Do you have one more?
Yeah.
Go ahead.
About the Pelicans.
Okay, go ahead.
Well, sadly, they have put the same manager for the Pelicans as we have for the Saints.
Mm-hmm.
I think he's lost his touch. But with the Pelicans, we have a summer league that we played.
Mm-hmm.
And on the Pelicans team was, the MVP's younger brother, Stephen...
Curry.
Seth Curry.
Yeah.
So, yeah.
Yes.
He played with the Pelicans.
Mm-hmm.
He was the leading scorer for the summer league. We didn't sign him. I mean, what's the problem here?
I'm going to let that panel answer that question. Thanks for the call, Julie. Very astute.
Yes.
Why don't you take the Curry comment first, the Curry question.
Sure. So Seth Curry, the summer league, you're not under contract when you play in the summer league. It's really just kind of an amalgamation of guys that everybody wants to work out. You have an advantage in signing them, but there's nothing that holds them to you at any. So it's not as if Dell Demps let him walk.
Right.
He ended up getting a 2-year guaranteed contract from Sacramento. The Pelicans did not want to give him more than 1 year. So by him getting a 2-year contract, he was able to take that and go. And quite frankly, he didn't fit a lot of what the Pelicans wanted to do as far as at that guard position, because they need someone who's a little bit more defensive oriented to come in and spell some of those other guys. So that was more of a depth issue and a contract issue than it was them letting him walk.
Darren Sproles, Malcolm Jenkins.
Oh, big topic.
Sproles did not perform well the year before he got traded. Malcolm Jenkins and Roman Harper, that they were people who wanted to drive him. I was right there with him to the airport.
No problem.
Okay. Neither one could catch. Neither again. You took the salaries you would have paid for both of them, and you paid Jarris Bird. Mm-hmm. I think the biggest problem right now is Jarris Bird hadn't been on the field.
Right.
Maybe if Jarris Bird was on the field contributing, you wouldn't be in a situation where you'd be looking back and seeing Malcolm Jenkins with five interceptions this year, and of course Roman Harper still leading that Carolina defense. Now on top of Sproles, who has shown that, you know, maybe he had a down year, but he's not finished.
Yeah, no doubt about it. And I think one thing that people tend to forget, right? A, it's always easier to go back in the future and see what those decisions are, good or bad, right? But, you know, I keep making this point on my show, and I think it's one that we kind of tend to forget. And it's the reason I brought up a pair of $40 million contracts in Gillette and Graham that never made it to their second year of their deal.
Yes.
When you pay Breeze the money you do, and we all agree he deserved it.
Sure.
But when you do that, Seattle's about to learn. You know, the Colts are about. When you do that, you only have so much money. So because of that, you can't forget as a fan that you had to, whether it's Moore, Pierre Thomas, Harper, Jenkins, you had to keep restructuring their deal. Mm-hmm. They had to sign one-year deals. They had to do all these different things because you couldn't pay them long-term to do that. Most of the reason that you did let them go, probably some of those thought you could get better athletically, it was the money. It's the money. You couldn't afford to pay Harper and Jenkins and Sproles if you wanted to sign Graham to the contract you wanted. If you wanted to keep Gillette, you knew Cam Jordan was coming up for a deal. It's just, it's literally that simple. Drew Brees' deal, and then it's a pyramid as to where it needs to go, and fans can't forget. They would have kept them if they wanted to play for a cheaper price, but then you get in the locker room and go, well, how come Scott's getting the money, but I'm not?
But Malcolm Jenkins is a heck of a lot cheaper than Jarris Bird.
Oh, absolutely.
He's doing a heck of a lot more.
100%.
Absolutely. Harper and Jenkins, and that's what you're paying Bird.
Right.
So they took a chance.
They did. They thought they were one player away.
Yeah.
Julie was on it.
Right.
Management is the issue.
No doubt. And as far as the kickoffs go, Morsett's done a great job at kicking the ball off. He's one of the top kickers in the league at touchbacks. They may change this going forward now with Hocker being, and Hocker's proven, he put it in the end zone. Hopkins did it in the preseason, so we may see that change going forward. Let's grab Chris from Bay St. Louis before we go to our break. Chris, welcome. Welcome to Inside New Orleans Sports. Thanks for calling. Chris, you with us?
Yeah, hi, guys. I really enjoy your program. A couple things I wanted to bring up. First, with Breeze's contract coming up, do you actually think he's going to be here with all the other problems that we've got all over the team? And secondly, at one time, this offense, what I call it is a fear factor, you know. We played against a lot of teams. We had a lot of people thinking about what they were going to do. And with Peyton's diverse offense, but that fear factor seemed like it's gone down the road. So I'm just going to hang up and listen to you guys.
Thank you, Chris, from Bay St. Louis. Appreciate it. First of all, they don't have the playmakers they once had, so that's why they're not fearful. The offense is the same. They've scaled it back to more of a dink-and-dunk offense, but if they had the playmakers, they'd be just as prolific. You know, that's a big question about Breeze going forward on whether they're going to keep him. Scott, I'll take you first. What are your thoughts? $30 million against the cap next year.
Cool.
Do you extend him? And I asked this question to the panel last week. Do you think Breeze would play for $20 million or less in the last few years of that deal?
No. I don't think he's shown any willingness to take less money to make his team better. And quite frankly, you can't expect him to. If someone decides to do it, Tom Brady has pushed money around, whatever, then that is, you know, wonderful on their part. The Saints have given themselves a poison pill. $30 million cap hit is a humongous, that's like the NBA.
Yes.
I mean, except they got 15 guys and not 53.
Exactly.
Talking, that's Anthony Davis is getting that percentage of the cap. So this is it's a massive poison pill for someone who we don't know is still a Pro Bowl caliber player. I don't know it. Right. I haven't seen it from Drew Brees in at least 2 years.
Yes.
Yeah, I mean, look, and I know Scott's not saying that he's a bum and it's time for Garrett Grayson. That's not what he's saying. He's still good, but $30 million is $30 million. And he brings up an interesting point. Look, Tom Brady's been that guy that done it, but no one's saying that about Aaron Rodgers and all that. But again, it's how that team's been managed. I use the Packers as a massive comparing tool all the time. So several reasons. One, both coaches wanted that job, right?
Yes.
McCarthy got the job, and Peyton's open about it. He wanted the Green Bay job. They both won a Super Bowl in that same time frame. But Their roster this year, guys, 53-man roster, 35 are draft picks. Right.
They home grow their players.
Three are free agents. Mm-hmm. There you go. Right. I mean, that's what it is. So if he stays, the only way he is what you said. And here's the thing that really stood out to me. Anytime you asked Peyton or Loomis in the offseason about Breeze's contract, it was almost like you insulted their mother. They'd give you a look. They'd be like, well, why would you even ask me? It's untouchable. No. No, no contract's untouchable to be able to work and help you. So you have to give them the extension, two-year deal, $10 million each year. Give them the signing bonus to make him happy, mm-hmm. millions of wise, and you can stretch out. It's the only way you can do it. He's not playing for $30
million. I can't imagine he's going anywhere. Yeah, he's not going anywhere. Exactly. They can't, number one, he is what he is,
he's
this franchise.
Too.
Right, yeah. Exactly right.
You have a season ticket base that is going to be fragile at the mm-hmm. end of this season.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
If you lose Drew Brees, everyone is going to panic.
Yes.
You just can't.
Right.
It's impossible. They'll restructure.
No, I would agree. They have to. They don't have a choice. They have to restructure. The question is, what will that number be per year against the cap going forward? And that's the key. Because, again, $12 million already in dead money because of Gallette.
Yeah.
Morstead's got a huge deal.
Mm-hmm.
You've got Jari Evans, you've got Zach Strief, and you got Marcus Colston. All dead money when you let them go next year. And I can't see them hanging on to maybe anyone but maybe Strief at this point. And then maybe not, because you have the number one pick that's waiting in the wings.
That's exactly right.
Going to take a quick break. We'll be right back. You're watching Inside New Orleans Sports. Great panel for you tonight. Gus Kattengill and Scott Kushner.
Inside New Orleans Sports with Eric Asher is underwritten by...
Located on Lake Pontchartrain, Brisby's Lakefront Restaurant and Bar offers traditional West End favorites, a scenic view, oysters, and numerous tasty options. More information is available at 504-304-4125 or brisbysrestaurant.com. Mr. Ed's Oyster Bar and Fish House has been shucking here since 1979. Located at 3117 21st Street in Metairie, Mr. Ed's Oyster Bar and Fish House offers raw, fried, and grilled oysters, as well as a range of Cajun and Creole dishes. Enjoy a dozen with a smile. WLAE is currently looking for partners to underwrite this program and other programs on our station. Underwriting on WLAE is affordable, brings exposure to your cause or company, and helps support our nonprofit mission of providing television programs that educate, inform, and inspire the viewers of Greater New Orleans and Southeast Louisiana. If you are interested in learning about program underwriting on WLAE, please contact us at 504-830-3703.
Welcome back to Inside New Orleans Sports. I'm your host, Eric Asher. Gus Kattengill of 100.3 FM in New Orleans, ESPN. And Scott Kushner of The Advocate, the New Orleans Advocate, are our guest. We're going to move on to LSU, Tulane, and the Pelicans. We will take your calls at 866-3200. And we'll take some Saints calls as well. 44-20, LSU over Eastern Michigan. They played down to their competition last week. They're now 4-0. Tragedy, obviously, in South Carolina right now. If anybody knows about the flooding situation and again, breaches in levees and dams, we do. And, of course, that game has now been moved to Tiger Stadium. 2:30 on ESPN, which I was a little bit surprised that, again, it went at 2:30 and it was on ESPN. But with that said, really good fortune for LSU.
Right. Well, yeah, I mean, for sure, because I looked at it not like the Syracuse game, guys, mm-hmm. but it could be a bit of a trap game in that you're looking at a team going into it, and this is before the flooding and everything, 0-3 in the SEC, 2-3 overall, and you're wondering if LSU, because of the Florida beatdown of Ole Miss, are you not looking forward to mm-hmm. that Gator game in Tiger Stadium, right? So I think it being at home will sort of help, obviously, in that situation, but I think when you're talking about Eastern Michigan game and playing down to it, it's a young team. People have to remember it's a young team. Leonard Fournette, I think you all would agree, probably the leader on the field,
yes,
right?
Sure.
I mean, I love his leadership.
He elevates
quality.
The play
Absolutely.
Of everybody.
Absolutely. He's a sophomore.
Right.
Okay. And Brandon Harris, who I think has played really well, and mm-hmm. I think a lot of fans misinterpret the passing game as his issue. He's hitting receivers in their hand, they're dropping it. I think he's made good decisions with the ball. He has one pick the entire year, and I think they're slowly but surely putting it in his hands and letting him make the decisions. I think it's a talented team, but it's a young team. So that's what happens with youth, I think, Eric. They get up for the big games, and it's harder for the games that against Eastern Michigan.
Right. Scott, what could you add about the Tigers? Again, right now, obviously Fournette is the heart and soul of this team right now, but I agree with Gus. I like what Brandon Harris is doing. I like the young defense. And ultimately, again, the wide receivers have to help the young quarterback.
If you have the best player on the field, it goes a long way. Right. And you'd be hard-pressed to find anybody in the country who's better than Leonard Fournette. I mean, that's just the way it is. They're going to lean on him, and we've seen LSU do basically just run an offense through its running backs with worse running backs and a worse offensive line and be incredibly successful. So we know what they're going to do. And basically, Brandon Harris just has to not turn the ball over. They have to continue to play the defense that they're playing, which I think Kevin Steele has done a very nice job. Right. They've got a lot of athletes on the field. They're very young.
Yes.
But at the same time, when you look at this game changing, it's going to really help LSU because that was a trap game written all over it. 11 a.m. kickoff in South Carolina, a team that's not really a rival, a team that's kind of has been good in the past but is not playing well at all. I mean, that, like, there are nine reasons to list why that team was going to come out flat again in Columbia. Being home, being at 2:30, and now there's some buildup and some real excitement for this game. Everything's kind of changed with it. So I was looking at that, you know, being like, it was like a 12-point spread, saying that looks like a pretty easy bet for South Carolina. I think it's going to be a close game. Now it's like 18, 19 points.
Yeah.
LSU is probably a significant favorite.
One of the things I'll add, too, we spoke with somebody from that area, and, you know, there's been no class all week for the students, and I didn't realize this, but Scott, a lot of there hadn't been power, so a lot of those students haven't. So your practice week isn't normal. Mm-hmm. All of that isn't normal. Now you're having to fly down here, and for LSU, you can wake up. Even if it would have been 11 a.m., you're waking up in your apartment, in your hotel or whatever it is that you are, and it's a lot different. But again, them having to deal with practice, not having power, and just the inconvenience of, you know, what it's like after a storm-ravaged area, I think that's a lot for South Carolina to overcome if LSU gets up early.
But I will say this, Gus. We know a little bit about teams that get motivated off of tragedy.
No, they're playing for the area.
And they're playing for South Carolina.
Correct.
And there's something to be said for that, playing maybe a little bit over your head. Mm-hmm. LSU right now, what, fifth in the USA poll, seventh in the AP right now. So, again, when you look at where LSU is right now, they're in the catbird seat, but I would not take the South Carolina team.
Hankies will be the key.
Oh, I'm telling you. And
if
look,
LSU
we've seen that as
Syracuse.
Well. Syracuse. You know, we've seen
you
that
made
well.
That game you know? Closer because
if
of
it's, if it's close with an official and you got it. Look, we've been on the good end of that. Before with Saints Tulane and you know and LSU after a tragedy. So sometimes, you know, it's human nature. You know, the Hankies may fall the way of the Gamecocks. Let's move on to Tulane because I want to get back to the phone lines. Both you guys involved with Tulane. Obviously, Scott, you're covering Tulane. You're the sideline reporter for Tulane. I want to tell you right now, I thought Tulane played a fantastic game against UCF. The defense was ferocious. They got back to their ball-hawking ways in the secondary. When you look at Tanner Lee, I thought it was his best performance as a Greenie. He looked like he was composed. He knew where to go with the football. Scott, I'll start with you first. Your thoughts on this Green Wave team? They're stepping up in class now, going to Temple. Mm-hmm. But I think that they showed something this past weekend.
They showed something. Now UCF is pretty much dead in the water. That was a team that looked like they were ready to be beaten when things started going wrong. But Tulane also took it in a lot of ways. They ran a fake punt early in the game, which really swung the momentum of that game. They made some really big hits. They, like you said, they were ball hawking a little bit. The key to this entire thing is going to be Tanner Lee. If he can convert third downs, all of a sudden Tulane can play with this run of four undefeated teams in a row they're playing against. If he has to scramble out of the pocket, look for three guys, they have like four scholarship receivers on the whole team, then you've got problems. They have got to keep it third and short. They've got to be able to convert. And this team has to play clean football. And that has not been the real strength under Curtis Johnson the last few years, is playing very clean and smart football games. So that's going to be a huge issue. For
Can't get any closer to the action than you do on the sidelines.
Right.
Talk about this Tulane team.
He's absolutely 100%. And not to put a lot of pressure on the kid, but then again, you are a redshirt sophomore. You've been in that offense 3 years. And if anything, I've been not critical, but he's got to figure it out. And it's got to figure it out soon. You're starting to see those signs. But you've been in this offense for three seasons, and it absolutely is about him. Look, last year, Tulane had several 200-plus yard rushing games. Well, now everybody knows that. So guess what you're going to do when you go there? Tanner Lee's got to beat me, right? We're starting to see, you know, Devin Bro, and you're starting to see Teddy Veal be able to be playmakers. Throw the ball up there for them, they'll go get it. But it starts with the quarterback. You got to know what you want. The touchdown pass to Veal, I was quickly, you know, talking to Todd. I'm like, come down to me. Because you could see it on the sideline, his eyes moving. When a quarterback starts using his progressions and starts going through the routes, that's when you can start saying he's getting it. It's slowing down enough, but a lot of it has to be the trust. Is this line going to protect me? I got to be able to have that time to do so. So the line has to protect, has to block, and has to help him out. But it is. It's all about that, because then you can see what the defense can do. Brother Martin, rookie's freshman starting this year at safety. He had an interception in Teamer. Perry Nickerson's play to not give up on that play changed the complexity of the game. So the potential's there. And, you know, he mentioned about in the Curtis Johnson era about them being sloppy and seeing that. The punter drops the ball. It's almost like Tulane has to get over that and believe in themselves and have confidence. The ability is there. They're much better talented athletes than they have been.
Right.
It's now learning to win. And
it's not a not a skill issue. It really isn't. Right. It's
and you haven't been able to always say that.
No, it's not. But it's not that they're slower than the team they're playing. Right. It's not they're weaker than the team they're playing. They got to play smarter.
Rick Dixon is retiring. Let's talk about the program long term. Look, I've already come out. I'm on the soapbox. I know who I would like to see as the Tulane athletic director. It's Arnie Philko. Mm-hmm. To me, Philko wants the job. When you look at his qualifications from the Southern League in baseball to the New Orleans Saints to what he's doing with the National Basketball Players Association to what he did for the New Orleans City Council in terms of their budget. Mm-hmm. You know, I've spoken on the show. I've spoken about it on social media. I don't think there's a better candidate out there for this Tulane job than Arnie Philko. Now, with that said, there are some other candidates that are lining up that, again, the Tulane family may look at and like. What do you guys think about the upcoming AD's job?
I think it's a pretty monstrous, actually, hire, to be honest with you. Your facilities are coming on board and getting up to par. Look, I get it, and I'm going to see it firsthand, right, the next four games that Tulane's going to be playing in the American Conference. But there's a reason they went there. My wife's asked me, friends, why did you go in there like a heart of this? Because of that. You want that. The TV deals, you're playing on the family of ESPN networks a lot more. You're being seen more. You know what? I call play-by-play for women's basketball, and you've seen the impact in recruiting just because you can say we're playing at UConn every year. And I've seen the freshmen this year in the teams. They're better. The game's getting better. So you have to get better to compete. And the teams that you're playing, again, four undefeated teams in the conference play. It's a better conference. And I think with that, you've seen you have a football stadium now in Yeoman. Baseball's about to get some additions and renovations there. The basketball arena has as well. But you bring up a very good point about Arnie Philko. So much, especially at Tulane, maybe not at LSU, it's more about the budget and, you know, it's you walk in, I can AD LSU. Right. You have to be a politician. Right. Unfortunately,
you
that's what it
is. You've got to be able to market the program.
You have to be able to go to the street behind the stadium and make those people happy.
Right.
You got to be able to shake hands
Rick
and talk to
Rick Dixon
people.
Built the facilities.
Right.
But he got the big money people on board. What he did not get was the grassroots support of the city of New Orleans.
Right.
He lost that in droves over the last 10 years.
True.
Since Katrina, they have really lost pretty much their entire core audience. We see it every day because we hear from the same people all the time. And the crowds, unless they're winning big or playing someone really big, keep getting smaller. Their season ticket bases. And in the other sports, football obviously with the stadium changed. Right. But they need someone who can build grassroots support and knows how to run a department. Arnie Philko does fit those. I think you'll also see Scott Sidwell get
that's
a look at the University of San Francisco.
Mm-hmm.
Played for Rick Jones in the mid-90s. He a good family name in New Orleans, another guy who can build support. And Kevin White's son, who is Kevin White, former Tulane AD, now at Duke. He's at Buffalo right now. Mm-hmm. They made a run in the NCAA tournament. They hired Bobby Hurley.
Right.
I mean, there are guys out there with Tulane connections who want this job.
And it's understanding getting younger in youth.
Right.
I mean, you go to an LSU game or you go to other schools and there's kids and everything. The stadium has done that. It is pretty cool to see the tailgating. I do the pregame show from the quad, and there are kids now wearing Tulane shirts and playing football with that. And that was always the argument between the dome and having it on-campus stadium. But it's realizing that. You know, you can't be Bill Belichick and say I'm on InstaFace and FaceGram or whatever. You have to use social media. You have to get out there, and you have to understand that you embrace things like that and a younger fan base.
Well, I agree with you guys. I mean, I've said it all along. I've been saying it since I've been on the air. You know, Tulane's biggest mistake is they didn't replenish the fan base. Mm-hmm. You had to get out to the playgrounds. You got to get out to the schools. And when you were in that cavernous dome, you should have been giving tickets away to try to get the young kids in, to drag the parents in, because that's how you build a program base in terms of fans. This next AD has got to be a marketer. He's got to be a guy that can fundraise, but he's also got to be a guy that's keen on understanding how these programs work and getting the best coaches in place. So hopefully, again, they'll make the right decision. New Orleans Pelicans. Scott, I'll take you first. Your thoughts about this team. You got a team that ultimately didn't go outside the organization to upgrade the team. They're banking on this team being healthy and a new system to get them over the top in the West. Your thoughts?
Not a great start at being healthy.
No, not at all.
Quincy Pondexter hurt, Alexis Ajinja hurt, Horacek hurt, and Drew Holiday on a minutes restriction. So not a great start. None of those should really affect too much time as far as the season goes. But going to practice, speaking with Gentry, speaking with players, the atmosphere in that building, it is very hard to translate it, to say to people, look, there's a big difference in that building. Just the confidence level of all these players that they have that are saying, oh, they're counting on me. You know, Eric Gordon told us they had 15 defensive calls. They had more defensive calls than offensive calls in some games last year. Now they got three. He's trusting these guys. Mm-hmm. And this was the whole point, is that they trusted the roster more than they trusted the coaching staff. Mm-hmm. So they went ahead and they kept everybody together and they got rid of the coaching staff and brought in someone who's going to let those guys work. And this is the experiment. And they've got the best young player, at least in the NBA, to go work it around. And what more can they ask for?
I want to say, when I was on your show last time, we talked about the Pels. Mm-hmm. We talked about how a change would benefit and why I thought the Pels were going to be a better team. What was it, Scott? You know this, 10, 11 games last year to sub 500 teams.
Yes. Yeah.
Okay, let's say you win half of those, that's five more wins. Two or three games you blew leads in the fourth quarter. Let's say we win those. You look in the fourth quarter where the turnovers were something that was not out the ordinary. You look at that first preseason game, I know, I get it, it is what it is, but 103 shots put up, 11 turnovers.
The pace is going to be totally.
Yes.
This is the same roster. Anthony Davis looks like a totally different guy because Phil Weber told me, the assistant coach, you had the Ferrari in the garage.
Yeah.
In that you were not letting him run.
And he's Stoudemire with the Suns back in the day.
He's unstoppable in the open court. And he's much better than Stoudemire was then because
absolutely.
He can do more offensively. Yeah.
Now, guys, Kendrick Perkins, Alonzo G, Corey Webster from Australia. Chris Douglas Roberts, Bruce DeJean Jones. This is what the additions are.
Yeah.
Scott, I'll take you first. Any of these guys make the roster? If they do, any of these guys make an impact on this roster?
G is going to play. Alonzo G will be out there, particularly early. They're just going to need a wing player, and he can fill that role and shoot some threes. Kendrick Perkins, even as they're losing centers, Alvin Gentry isn't bringing his name up as far as someone who's going to be in the rotation. I mean, we're asking, what are they going to do? And he's saying they're going to go small, though. They're not saying we're going to play
Kendrick
Perkins.
He's saying we're going to unconventional
lines. Yeah,
right.
Exactly. Yeah. They're not saying we're going to go Kendrick Perkins.
I'm saying he's more of a locker room guy.
Yeah, he's absolutely a locker room guy who's been through wars and has already connected with Anthony Davis, which is very important for this team. The rest of those guys, you know, minimum contract guys, rookies that are, you know, Chris Douglas Roberts can do some stuff and make some shots. You've got guys on there with talent, but you're talking they're going to get rack up 30, 40 DNPs. These aren't guys that are going to play a lot beyond those two.
And you think of Golden State, to add a quick point to that, when they made that run last year and did it, we saw it in the Pelican series. We saw it in them making the run to the finals. A guy that comes up, Barbosa, plays 4 minutes, but in that 4 minute, hits a three, gets a foul, the crowd gets going. I think Gentry's building it very close to what you're going to see there. And it's, I think, a little deeper bench than it was last year.
Let's head back to the phone lines. Thanks so much for the patience, audience. Really appreciate it. Let's head to Slidell and Scott. Scott, welcome. You're on Inside New Orleans Sports. Hey, Scott.
Hey, guys. Thanks for taking my call.
Thank you for the patience.
Enjoy the show. I want to talk back about the Saints.
Sure.
Looking at the roster, 53-man roster, I believe 30 players have, 2 years or less experience in the NFL?
Yes.
And I was just wondering, if we decide to move on from Drew Brees, what would maybe be the value we could get?
Thanks for the call, Scott. I think you would get real value, because I think there are teams out there that feel they're one quarterback away from a Super Bowl.
I think a lot of it depends how the rest of the season goes with his shoulder. And if he can show that he can play well and still do that, absolutely. They'll be a team or so because, as Scott said early in the show, quarterback's the most valuable position in the NFL.
It's probably the most valuable position in sports if you consider, agreed. You know, just, you know, controlling half the game for every game of the season. It's like a starting pitcher. He's going to draw real value if they really do shop him. I mean, there are a lot of teams with really good rosters and really bad quarterbacks. Yeah. I mean, you look at Buffalo, tomorrow you put Drew Brees in that team, they could win 13 games. Mm-hmm. But then they don't have him. And there are a lot of teams. I mean, you're talking 6-7 teams that are going to give up multiple first-round picks if you wanted to get rid of Drew Brees. I don't think there's any way they let that happen. Yes. As long as Tom Benson is living, that there is no way that Drew Brees is leading this team.
I do agree as well. He would have to show a dramatic fall in terms of his ability, and I just don't think that's there yet. To Metairie and Tom. Tom, welcome. You're on Inside New Orleans Sports.
Hey, guys. I have Tom. Two questions.
Sure.
Number one, I don't think we talk nearly enough about the special teams for LSU. It seems like someone's going to bust one on a punt or a kickoff. I mean, every time we kick off a punt, these guys are making 20 and 35 yards. And number two, just give me an opinion on the record going forward to November. How do we look? How do we end up for the year? And I'll hang up. Thank you.
Thank you for holding, Tom. Appreciate it. Your thoughts first.
For LSU, for that record,
the special
goes,
teams first.
Yeah, special teams, look, I think a lot of it has to do with youth and trying to
but
get those
positions.
But it is
mind-boggling. They have some great athletes.
No, it is. But a lot of it has to do with how much do you spend time in practice in there. And at the end of the day, Scott will tell you this too. The player has to want to be on the special teams and play special teams and go out and do it. You're right. It's mind-boggling. You have the speed. You have the athleticism.
Yeah, you do. You do. Scott?
They'll be fine. I really do think that's something that's very correctable, because it's not that they don't have the body. We watched Tulane for a long time, didn't have the body.
Right. Didn't have the speed.
And when you put athletes in space, those athletes usually win. Mm-hmm. But this team has those bodies. It's a matter of it's correctable, in my opinion, at least.
I kind of think LSU's going to be undefeated going into November.
I
got to be honest.
I would have never thought that either going into it, but you mentioned the young defense. Mm-hmm. He mentioned Steele's job doing that. Again, I love what they're doing with Brandon Harris. You mentioned, I've been saying this, that LSU with the blue chippers and the players that you have, your quarterback needs to not step on his foot out of center, not fumble it on a handoff, and literally just get the ball out of your hands and get it to the receivers as quickly as possible. Be smart with your decisions. You can run the Aaron Brooks style offense where you just roll. Yeah. That first touchdown to against Auburn, right? He rolls right, the running back's at the goal line, the tight end's in the corner, or he runs or he throws it in the stands.
That's
smart.
That's how they need to play
exactly
him.
Right.
He has athletic ability that
he's
he
got
can
a
make
great
a first
arm.
Down at any time, get him on the edge, two progressions. If it's not there, run. That's it.
And he can make
and
the throws.
He's spectacular in zone read.
He really
too.
Is.
I think he's a complete weapon at zone read. And with Leonard Fournette next to you and that offensive line in front of him, that offensive line has been incredible. I think somebody's saying, you know, Leonard Fournette has fewer yards after contact than almost any other running back. Yeah. And he's getting and he's got more yards than anybody.
Exactly right.
It's because he didn't get touched until he's 10 yards down the field.
Yeah.
I mean, really, that line is opening stuff up. And if you have that zone read where he can keep it in the belly or he can, I mean, all of a sudden you've got a very
dangerous
get past
the trap game, you know, I think, again, Saturday being at home helps. You can get past Florida. Again, that's a Saturday night game, 6 o'clock kickoff. It'll be fun. And Florida should have lost to Jacksonville, whoever it is, Jacksonville State. So it's in there. They can go to Tuscaloosa undefeated.
Quickly, LSU undefeated going into November?
Undefeated going into November. I think they probably lose to Alabama and they beat everybody else. Okay. I think they'll be right in the mix.
Saints win, Saints lose in Philly?
I got the Saints winning somewhere like 27-23.
Yeah, Saints losing 21-17.
Okay. Tulane goes to Temple. They win or lose?
They probably lose as well.
Yeah.
Okay.
you can't say anything.
LSU South Carolina.
Temple's a real good game. LSU wins.
Scott. LSU 35-14.
What a great panel you guys have been tonight. Thanks so much, Scott Kushner of The Advocate. Congratulations, Gus,
absolutely.
On the new show.
Thank
100.3
so
FM, 11-1. Mm-hmm. Well, you know, same time as me.
Get two radios.
There you go. Two radios. Thanks so much for tuning in. Remember, there's a rebroadcast of this program each and every Friday night at 10 p.m. on WLE, 9 p.m. on Pelican Sports Television on Friday night in the New Orleans, Baton Rouge, and Lafayette Marcus. You can catch me on the radio, 9:09 a.m. WGSO, 11 a.m. until 1 p.m. Also on the TuneIn radio app, as well as at ericasher.com, where you can check out all the previous episodes of Inside New Orleans Sports. Special thanks to our guests. Great panel tonight. Gus Cattingill, Scott Kushner. Also to the WLAE production staff, including Ron Yeager, Jim Dotson, Donovan Joseph, Kenny Juno, also Richard King, and my director, William Hill. New Orleans, thanks so much for watching. We'll see you right back here next week for Inside New Orleans Sports.
Inside New Orleans Sports with Eric Asher is the first place award winner of the 2015 New Orleans Press Club's Excellence in Journalism Award for the category of Best TV Sports Show.